Good early afternoon, folks. My name is Dr. Christopher Jimenez-West. It's my honor to serve as a faculty member here at Pasadena City College. And it's my double honor to be able to present the speaker to you. One of the big reasons why you're here as part of the One Book, One College series is connected into the Pathway program. The college has made an investment. And part of that investment is that we're trying to fundamentally shift the way that we think about the process of getting you into the campus, helping you to, in many ways, orient yourself to the campus, and more importantly, in the long term, getting you out of here to whatever your intended goal is, be that credential or transfer to a UC or CSU system school. Well, there's a professionalization process that goes along with that, and part of that is intellectual inquiry. We are a teaching institution, but we also want you to understand the intellectual underpinnings of what it means to pursue an undergraduate education. And we do that in many ways through the One Book, One College series, which you've been reading, the book called Southland. I want to start by introducing Hillary Jinks just by, we're going to give her, she has no idea this is going to happen, I'm going to embarrass the heck out of her. But yesterday was her birthday, so we're going to sing her happy birthday. So I can't sing, so you're just going to have to follow, so be it. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Hillary. Happy birthday to you. Woo! It's personal. I've had the honor of knowing Dr. Hillary Jinks for upwards of 10 years. We were both in graduate school at the University of Southern California. Okay. they're doing horribly in football. Please no celebration. She is truly a scholar. She is truly an intellectual. And she is truly an individual who puts her heart and her soul into her academic work. It is my honor to introduce you, Dr. Hillary Jinks.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. And I wanted to thank Professor Ling and Professor Jimenez-West for inviting me here to speak to you today. I never can live up to the hype of his introductions of me, but I will do my best. And I also want to thank you guys for being here today. I'm sure you'd rather be eating lunch because it's that time, but we're going to have fun, we're going to learn a lot, and we're going to hopefully provide you with some foundations that will help a little bit when you come to reading Nina Rivard's beautiful novel, Southland, as you are for the One Book, One College initiative. So I just want to start by asking a question. I know there have been some tours, I don't know how many people went on them, but how many people in the room, just raise your hand, have been to Little Tokyo before? Wow, large chunk of you. Okay, so maybe you've gone to the museum. Yeah, maybe you went to eat. It's good food. Okay. How many people, same thing, raise your hands, have been to the Jefferson Crenshaw neighborhood before? A lot less hands. Okay, that's kind of what I thought was going to happen. One question. Do you see any connection between those two places? All right, Little Tokyo, Crenshaw, okay. You can get to them both on the 10, kind of, maybe. So one of the things that I wanted to talk today is about that, because very much like Jackie Ishida at the beginning of Southland, right? She comes to Crenshaw really as a stranger to a neighborhood that's been home to her family for three generations. And like her, we also have lost a lot of awareness of our histories, of our connections to place and the connections between places. In Southern California. And so what I'm going to do today is try to recover some of that and show you how, as Jackie comes to discover, there are deep connections between Little Tokyo and Crenshaw and between Japanese and African Americans in both of those places. So Little Tokyo, the way we know it today, right, all of you who raised your hands, you've been there, you know. It's a pretty small neighborhood. It's really only about 10 square blocks of downtown LA between the Civic Center and the LA River. But it hasn't always been Little Tokyo, right? At one point it was Little Berlin, and then at another point it was Bronzeville, and then Little Bronze Tokyo, and then Little Tokyo again. So that's a lot of names, right? It indicates a lot of upheaval, a lot of transition for such a small little neighborhood. And what I want you to think about is, why is that? Right? What forces brought these different groups of people into the neighborhood? What pushed them out again? And how did the people who encountered each other there really negotiate the relative needs, the challenges, the claims on the space, right? Who belongs in Little Tokyo? So when we think about this neighborhood, it helps to remember it has both a really long history and kind of a relatively short history. So there was actually a Tongva settlement not far from City Hall before the Spanish came to California. But following the missions and then the pursuant U.S. takeover of California, the neighborhood we've come to know as Little Tokyo by the late 19th century, you gotta kinda use your imagination, but mostly you're thinking about, like, there's stables, there's one-story wooden houses, there's warehouses. You can see the MoCA, the Geffen Contemporary, behind the Japanese American National Museum is in one of those old warehouses. And there also used to be citrus orchards. If you ever go down to the Japanese American Cultural and Community Center, they have a grapefruit tree in the plaza, which is sort of the lone remaining grapefruit tree from back when it was all citrus orchards down there. So it's got the river on the eastern end, and then Main Street is kind of the western boundary of Little Tokyo. And the land kind of slopes up from the river to Main Street. And back before the river was all encased in concrete, it used to flood, right? We get those spring rains. Sometimes we get a lot of rain in a very short period of time. And the river used to flood, sometimes all the way up to Main Street. So it's not the hottest place you want to live if you don't want to have to be constantly, you know, sweeping water out of your basement. So because of that, the rents are pretty low. And that's why it's a place that attracts immigrants and attracts communities that are facing racial discrimination, because it's not an expensive place. Before 1900, you could have called the area Little Berlin, because the Germans were the single largest nationality group in the neighborhood, right? So from Little Berlin to Little Tokyo. And it also, it had, you know, Jewish secondhand stores and Irish saloons and Chinese laundries, really mixed place. It was also one of the original black neighborhoods of LA, before African Americans spread west to Central and then down both sides of the avenue. So there, Bob Owens, who was an African American who lived here in LA in the 1850s and 60s, he had a corral and a stables down on 2nd and San Pedro. Biddy Mason, if you've ever heard of her, she's a very famous midwife who came to California with her master. She'd been a slave, and she got her freedom. She owned property down there, too. And William Seymour, who's a famous African-American preacher, he started the Pentecostal movement in 1906, right down on Azusa Street, which there is no more Azusa Street, but it's where the Japanese American Cultural and Community Center is today. So this is a neighborhood where African Americans had roots a long time before Bronzeville. And really, Japanese immigrants don't enter into this scene until 1886. There's a former sailor named Hamanosuke Shigeta, and he opened up a restaurant that served American-style food on East 1st Street. And about 2 years later, there was a Japanese boarding house, and people used to call it, in English, the Japanese YMCA. So, still pretty, not a lot of people though, right? I mean, we're looking at, by the 1900 census, it said, oh, there's 150 Japanese people in the whole city of LA. That's it. But it grows really fast after that. And within 5 years, they had a tailor, a doctor, a dentist, a baker, a confectionery store. If you've ever been to Fugetsudo in Little Tokyo, that's been there since 1903. Right? The Rafu Shimpo, the newspaper, gets established that year, too. So by 1905, that's when the Anglos in Los Angeles start calling the area Little Tokyo. And by the early 1920s, it's the established social and commercial center for the Issei, the immigrant generation, and the Nisei, the second generation of Japanese Americans who were born here. And they, you know, they fished and farmed and they sold plants and produce all over LA County. So there's pockets of Japanese Americans living all over LA County, but Little Tokyo is kind of the institutional place. It's got the churches and the temples, the Japanese school, the stores, right? This, however, is a point that's worth noting about Little Tokyo. It sounds, you know, Little Tokyo. Well, everyone there must be Japanese, right? That's why they call it Little Tokyo. But that's not really the case, right? The name tends to make you think that and expect that, but it really obscures the considerable and continuing diversity among the residents and those who were there on a daily basis, even if they didn't live there. So there's a gentleman named Koyoshi Uono, and he did a study of Little Tokyo back in 1928. And he said, well, there's 30 rooming houses and hotels here in this neighborhood, but out of those, a whole third of them are only for white laborers, still, even in the late 1920s when everybody calls it Little Tokyo. By 1940, only about 20% of the county's ethnic Japanese lived in Little Tokyo. But you can see from his map, tons of businesses, bathhouses, the temples, dentists, doctors, services, right, are all located here and centralized here. By 1940, only about, so between 29 and 36 of the population of Little Tokyo is Japanese American. It has substantial numbers of white residents and black residents, and the census at the time said Spanish surnamed residents. And that diversity marked a lot of pre-war LA. You might have started recognizing this from reading Southland, right? So you can think about Boyle Heights was similarly diverse. West Adams, the area around USC, whoever was cheering. That West Adams area, the Japanese called it Seinan, or Southwest. There was a lot of mixed African and Japanese Americans there. And some areas of Pasadena too, right? Northwest Pasadena. So there's a long tradition that Bronzeville continued of communities negotiating shared space despite, you know, language differences or job competition and racial discrimination. But what's different about Bronzeville and Little Tokyo that I kind of want to talk about today is how the state intervention really shaped the neighborhood in a way that's kind of distinctive and is significant to the future of LA and the future of mixed neighborhoods like that. So you guys probably know the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941, right? And within a few months of that, the president signed an executive order that allowed the military to go forward with removing all ethnic Japanese from the West Coast. So whether you were an alien, if you were a citizen of Japan, or if you'd been born here and you were a citizen of the US, they didn't care. They said, if you're ethnically Japanese, we are removing you. So this is a two store windows in Little Tokyo with messages from the folks who were being evacuated. And so first they get moved to temporary assembly centers at places like Santa Anita Racetrack. So if you've ever been to the horse races, that was an initial assembly center. And later to camps built away from the coast by the War Relocation Authority. So one of the famous ones is Manzanar. That's the closest one to LA. But people also got sent as far away as Rower, which is all the way out in Arkansas. Well, by July 1942, the LA Times was writing an article about the victims of the evacuation. That's what they called them, the victims. But their article's not about the Japanese who got evacuated. Their article is about the Anglo and Jewish and Mexican-American property owners of Little Tokyo. And the paper said, quote, buildings that were once packed to the rafters with Japanese tenants were empty, but their taxes and other overhead goes on. So to the newspaper, oh, the poor landlords, they're out there renters and they don't have any money. The mayor of Los Angeles at that time, this is Fletcher Bowron, and he's, you know, if you think about where City Hall is in relationship to Little Tokyo, he literally has a ghost town on his doorstep every day when he goes to work. So he said, I don't know, I cannot understand their apparent inability to rehabilitate this area, talking about the property owners. But what he didn't understand was how thoroughly there was a certain representation and image of Little Tokyo, both locally and nationally, that shaped whether or not people wanted to be there. So for instance, that Times article, this is what it said about Little Tokyo. Quote, it is a city within a city used exclusively by Nipponese, which honest American citizens view with large and disturbing questions in their minds. Very negative. And then this, on a national level, they made this film in the summer of 1942 called Little Tokyo, USA. And in the prologue to the film, they said, quote, that Little Tokyo housed a vast army of volunteer spies steeped in the traditions of their homeland, Shintoists, blind worshipers of their emperor. So likewise, very negative, stereotypical view. So the property owners said, we have to remove all of these connotations that link this neighborhood to Japan. So the Miyako Hotel, they changed the name to the Civic Hotel, right? And they went through all those store windows, started scraping off all the Japanese characters, right? But didn't seem like most people were interested still in renting. Like you could scrape off the characters, but people were still thinking about the space as Little Tokyo. So the owners came up with this idea that they were going to turn the neighborhood into a Latin American quarter for consulates and trade organizations from Latin American countries, right? So we're in the middle of World War II, and these are now our allies, with our friends. And the neighborhood will be another colorful community asset. That's what the owners said they wanted. And I don't know if they were thinking about Olvera Street as a model, right? It's not very far from Little Tokyo. Or maybe it was this image here of property manager Ralph Strong, right? You'll notice he's scraping the kanji off the window. But if you can see along the bottom, it says, se habla español. That he's leaving. That can stay on the window, right? Which also kind of proves that the Times didn't know what it was talking about when it said it's a neighborhood used exclusively by Nipponese, because clearly not. So they tried that. That was their next big plan. And all the consulates and trade organizations said, thank you, but no thank you. That's a bunch of cultural baggage we just don't want to take on right now. And so the mayor actually started looking into using all the buildings of Little Tokyo for federal storage, document storage. He said, well, apparently we can't, they're not good enough for people because of this connection to Japan, so maybe we can use them for paper. And what neither the mayor nor the property owners realized or could foresee was that there was going to be the large numbers of African Americans arriving in the city. Because there's all these new employment opportunities in LA, right? If you're in need of a job in 1942, LA is a good place to go. There's shipbuilding plants, there's aircraft plants, right? We're ramping up all of our production because of the war. And the president, in addition to that executive order he signed that authorized internment, he also signed an executive order that said there can be no discrimination in hiring in defense plants on the basis of race, creed, color, or national origin. So for the first time, you could actually get a decent paying job, manufacturing job, if you are a person of color, right? So by mid-1943, the average every month, just the average, of African Americans arriving in LA was 5,500 people coming in every month for these jobs. And they need places to stay, right? It would be nice to have a roof over your head when you want to go to sleep. So the problem was 90% of the city of Los Angeles is covered by restrictive covenants, deed covenants. And these state that it is illegal for an African-American, and sometimes also it would say Mexican, Oriental, things like that, say illegal for an African-American to occupy this property. So that means 90% of the city they can't move to, they can't rent, they can't buy, they can't do anything. It's not a lot of space left for 5,500 people a month. So what happened was the areas that already had African-American populations, African-American neighborhoods, like West Adams, like Central Avenue, parts of Santa Monica, parts of Pasadena, they filled up really quickly, and then there was no more room. What there was Little Tokyo. It was empty, it was not restricted, and it was right by the train station. Even more convenient, right? So that's where people went to move, and that's where Bronzeville was born. And it really became a very critical situation over the course of the war, right? Because in addition to the fact that there was these 90% covered by covenants, they built 51,000 new housing units in LA over the course of the war, trying to house all these new people. And out of that 51,000, only 942 were open to African Americans. So that's less than 2%. So the new housing wasn't going to be an option. The old housing, most of it wasn't an option. So that's why we have Bronzeville. Given the magnitude of that influx, Bronzeville pretty quickly got overcrowded too, right? It went from a ghost town to its opposite. Before the war, there was maybe 7,500 Japanese Americans living in Little Tokyo, maybe 20,000 total in the whole neighborhood. By 1943, you're looking at 30,000 people. And then other estimates eventually climbed as high as 80,000 people. So if you went down there, you went on the tour, it's not a big neighborhood. Try to imagine 80,000 people living down there. Bronzeville exemplified the wartime paradox that black Angelenos really struggled with. This is historian Josh Sides. He's over at Cal State Northridge. He calls this the prosperous ghetto problem. You have these new employment opportunities. You have much better wages. But at the same time, the neighborhoods, the institutions are really suffering from the stress of welcoming all of these newcomers under these restricted circumstances. So one of the African-American folks who lived through this time, when he looked back on it, he said, "If things were so good, why were they so bad?" So they did a survey of 138 families living in Bronzeville in 1943 because the city was interested in trying to figure out what's going on in this neighborhood that's just kind of appeared. And they found that more than 55% of residents in Bronzeville were living in overcrowded conditions. So when I say overcrowded conditions, I'm talking about there was 5 people living in a room that had no windows and just one skylight for ventilation because it had been a storage room before the war. There was 30 people sharing one bathroom. There were 40 people sharing one toilet, which is too disgusting really to even ponder. So the city's public health officials, they kind of blamed the residents. They blamed the folks living in Bronzeville because the public health officials thought of them as these, you know, ignorant black Southerners. Oh, they don't know how to work a flush toilet. They don't know how urban garbage disposal works, right? That was the kind of things they would write about why there were these problems, which is ridiculous because what the survey showed was that fully 57% of the neighborhood's residents had an urban background. They'd come from another city. They understood how cities worked. Another 30% had come from small towns. The other thing is that, you know, now we've switched the name, right? We're calling it Bronzeville. Again, there's this presumption, well, everybody living here must be black. But that also, again, was not true. It remains a more diverse place than you would think. So only about 56% of the residents in 1943 were black. That probably climbed higher by the next year, but still, that's about half, just over half. Another 26% were ethnic Mexicans. There were 7% that were white. 20% of them came from somewhere else in California or the Southwest. They weren't even from a different region of the country. And Bronzeville's residents, they weren't unaware of or indifferent to the conditions that they were forced to live in, right? They said, you know, "We want to move out. We want to live anywhere but here." Those are the kind of quotes from the survey. But they weren't able to find better available housing because everything else was restricted. Bronzeville was crowded not only physically but spiritually. Specters of the building's previous occupants who weren't dead, just sent away by these unseen powers, filled up the space, the compressed space between the new residents. But at the same time, Bronzeville offered African Americans fresh opportunities for entrepreneurship, for cultural expression, right? All of these new people coming into this new space, there's a lot of energy. And it's a key area for newcomers trying to make a home in this city that hasn't been very welcoming so far. So black businessmen were really important in trying to create a community out of Bronzeville. And the name even comes from one of them. There was an entrepreneur named Leonard Christmas who came from Cambridge, Massachusetts. And he took over the Digby Hotel on kind of the eastern end of Little Tokyo. And he started in 1943 the Bronzeville Chamber of Commerce. And their slogan was, "This is Bronzeville, watch us grow." Right? So they borrowed the name really from Chicago's South Side, which became African-American, heavily African-American in the 1920s, and people started calling it Bronzeville. So they're like, "We're the Western Bronzeville." So the chamber, within a couple months, it grew and grew. All these people were starting up businesses. It had 125 members within a couple months. And they would do things like, in 1943, they had a Halloween party for the neighborhood, and 800 people showed up in costumes. They had a Miss Bronzeville beauty pageant, right? So it's a real effort to kind of, yeah, promote businesses, but also make people think of themselves as being part of a community, as having some connections to each other. And some of the neighborhood's greatest business successes, it's restaurants, it's nightclubs, it's breakfast clubs. A breakfast club, if you don't know, if you work the swing shift at the plants, because the plants were open 24 hours, because we had to produce a lot of planes and ships. So the plants were open 24 hours, and if you worked the swing shift and you got off at midnight or 1 a.m., well, you might still want to go out after work, right? But everything else is closing. So the breakfast clubs were places that stayed open and had bands and alcohol and all of that until 6 or 7 or 8 or 9 a.m., and you could go there after work. So Bronzeville had breakfast clubs and nightclubs, and these were also some of its greatest and most important cultural spaces. They really linked Bronzeville into what was going on nationally in African American music. So this is just some of the clubs that you can see kind of mapped onto Little Tokyo. There's the Cobra Club, there's the Creole Palace, Shep's Playhouse, Club Rendezvous, and the Finale Club, all kind of located right here around the heart of Bronzeville. And one LA resident, she was remembering these places, and she said, oh, the nightclubs were great. She said, Shep's Playhouse was nice, it was real nice. There was good music, and we had a good time. And Shep's is a really interesting place. It's operated by this guy named Gordon Shepherd. And he'd run a pool hall before this, and he'd also been a cameraman on black motion pictures. So he was connected into people in Hollywood also, and it became a really popular spot. It had performers like Coleman Hawkins and Herb Jeffries, Marva Lewis, T-Bone Walker. So if you know your music history, these are some pretty amazing people. And it became, because of that, a place to see and be seen. So then you get this integrated cavalcade of famous people coming down to the clubs to see these musicians. So Joe Louis, who was the heavyweight boxing champion, Louise Beavers, Judy Garland, Gene Kelly, these are all movie stars. Pearl Bailey is another one. And probably the most famous musician to play Bronzeville was Charlie Parker. If you've ever heard of him, he was a saxophonist. They call him the Bird. And he was one of the people who created bebop. It's a musical style of jazz. He came to the Finale Club in 1946 to play, and his band included Miles Davis, who was only 20 years old at the time, Joe Albany, Addison Farmer, and Chuck Thompson. So again, really famous jazz musicians. And the clubs also took on this role of, okay, we're gonna try to really make this space work as a neighborhood and tie it in to the other neighborhoods of Black LA. So the Finale Club held a fundraiser to purchase equipment for the local playground, the Bronzeville Playground. Club Rendezvous held a testimonial dance for Charlotta Bass, who published the California Eagle, which was one of the local black papers, and she was running for city council. So she didn't win, but it's still very remarkable that she was running for city council during World War II as a black woman in LA. And they were holding a fundraiser for her. And then Shep's co-sponsored this show for black veterans with help from the Eagle and the USO. So there were lots of activism that they were involved in addition to, you know, being a fun place to go. But despite kind of this assured declarations of this is Bronzeville, watch us grow, it wasn't ever a secure space for African Americans. It remained a kind of tenuous home. And a lot of the reason for that was because, you know, they still don't own the buildings. The property owners are still the same property owners that they were talking about in that LA Times article. And a lot of times that wasn't even clear to people. So, for example, the Cobra Club, the lease on the Cobra Club was owned by two Jewish gentlemen named Paul Mirabel and Saul Goldberg. But what they did was they hired a black entertainer named Earl Griffin, and he was the host. So a lot of people thought it was his club because he was the one who was there every night and greeted people, but he didn't own the club, right? Somebody else owns the club. Somebody else is making the money. So in January of 1945, that's when the exclusion order is lifted on Japanese Americans, and they can start coming back to the West Coast. So it's before the war's even over. The war doesn't end for another 9 months, but they can start coming back because at this point, we've started to win the war and people are a little less paranoid. So nobody knows what's gonna happen, right? Okay, Japanese Americans can start coming back, but how is this gonna work? How many are gonna come back? What's the situation going to be like, right? There's threats of vigilante violence. You can see in this headline, you know, protests over them coming back. What kind of discrimination are they gonna have to be dealing with? But for a lot of Japanese Americans, despite all of those reasons not to come back, there also was the fact that the West Coast was pretty much the only home they'd had, right? It had, especially for the Issei, for the older generation, it was where their friends had been. It was where all their community institutions were that maybe they could revitalize. If they'd been able to retain any property, that's where it was. So they came back. And by the end of 1946, about 60% of the pre-war population had come back, so between 25 and 28,000 Japanese Americans. You got to think about what a challenge that would be, right? I mean, you come out of camp, you don't have anything. They gave you about a month's worth of wages, basically, when you left camp, and that was it. And you come back, and the city is in a housing crisis. It's going into an economic crisis because we're in demobilization. As the war is winding down, you know, the plants are laying people off. And the main economic source for Japanese Americans before the war was the production and retailing of produce. And they've been out of that completely. You know, many people have lost their land, and other people have moved in the meantime, and it's gone. The other thing was, in addition to dealing with all of that and trying to come back and get reestablished, is that they had to deal with kind of state harassment. So, for example, if you went down to Little Tokyo, you may or may not have seen this building, the Koya-san Temple. It's down this little alley on First Street, and if you don't know just where to look to the side, you could miss it. But the congregation built this building in 1940 and then promptly got interned. And when they came back, they were using it as a hostel. A lot of people had nowhere to stay, so they literally put cots into the temple and hung up curtains, and people were staying there. And LA County approached them and said, "Will you owe us $5,000 in unpaid property taxes?" And the temple said, "What? What are you talking about?" And the county's twisted logic on this was, "Well, you're supposed to be a church, but you weren't fulfilling your church functions during the war, because, you know, the congregation wasn't here, they were being interned elsewhere. And now that you're operating as a hostel, that's a for-profit function. So we're gonna go back and charge you all 5 years worth of property taxes that you shouldn't have normally had to pay." So the temple board had to actually work out a payment schedule with the county to come up with $5,000 to pay them off, or else they were gonna lose this beautiful brand new building that they had, that they were using as a hostel where people lived. So that's an example of some of the challenges that they were experiencing. So the folks who came back and were staying at Koya-san or were staying at the Nishi Hongwanji Temple, which was also being used as a hostel, those are some of the first Japanese American faces back on the streets of what used to be Little Tokyo, but isn't Little Tokyo anymore, right? And coming back to this neighborhood that was so changed was really a bittersweet experience for a lot of folks. And it brought home to them that the pre-war world they had known and homes they had known were gone. So Archie Miyataki came back, and he said the first thing he did is he went to go see the place where he was born. But all of the buildings were gone, and instead there was a playground there, and it was called the Bronzeville Playground. So it was really clear to him, like, whoa, my home is gone. African Americans also were very quick to take on the role of welcoming back Japanese Americans, right? They weren't in the protest, they were welcoming. So January 19th, really early 1945, a group of Bronzeville businessmen hosted a welcoming reception at the Rendezvous Club. And then Kichi Ueda, he opened his store on March 30th, 1945, as the first Japanese American business to open in Bronzeville. And the black merchants in the neighborhood came and presented him with flowers to celebrate the opening. So this is, on the one hand, this is really hospitable, right? To say, welcome back, we hold no ill will, you know, we hope things go well for you. But at the same time, it really kind of demonstrated that African Americans had staked a claim to Bronzeville, because they said, well, we have the right to welcome you back. This is our neighborhood now, too. The ownership structure in Bronzeville, though, meant that nobody really had that neighborhood. Nobody owned that neighborhood in that sense, neither Japanese Americans nor African Americans, in terms of who having a say on who belonged there. So those same property owners, they faced the question about, well, is it better to keep renting Bronzeville's property to the black merchants and residents, or is it better to reestablish Little Tokyo by starting to rent to Japanese Americans when they come back? And the property owners overwhelmingly chose to do the latter. They repeatedly allowed Japanese Americans to buy out the leases of African American tenants when they would expire. And so Tal Watanabe, when he came back, he'd been a businessman in Little Tokyo before the war, and He worked out a 25-year lease with one of the Anglo property owners on First Street. And the condition was that he had to rent all of the storefronts in the building to other Japanese merchants. That was the property owner's stipulation. And the property owner said, quote, clean it all up within 2 years. So not surprisingly, these divergent experiences of African and Japanese Americans in the neighborhood led to rising tensions, right? Given the housing shortage, obviously African Americans didn't respond too well when Japanese American landlords would show up with these new subleases in hand and try to evict them. Where are they going to go? And then in 1947, the Japanese Businessmen's Association hired two Nisei Army vets to patrol the streets after dark. And this produced a wave of protest among the black residents. They said, this is a vigilante maneuver and that you are trying to, quote, force the Negroes out of this neighborhood. So the Council for Civic Unity, this was this group, the citywide group, they called a meeting. And Kenji Ito was a Nisei attorney. And he got up and he said, this is not about that. These patrols are because we don't have a sufficient police presence. The LAPD ignores this neighborhood. And we're just trying to make up for that by having these patrols at night. It's not directed against African Americans. So when he was asked directly, OK, are you trying to move us out? Ito's reply was very direct and very poignant. He said, Japanese don't believe in evacuation. So along with the process of trying to work out these tensions, there's also a lot of examples of African and Japanese Americans working together to make this neighborhood a harmonious one where they could both feel like they belonged. And the assistant police chief at the time, Joe Reed, he started calling it Little Bronze Tokyo. He said, I don't know what to call it to make sure that I'm addressing both of these communities that are laying a claim to this space. So he started calling it Little Bronze Tokyo. Kichi Ueda, you can see he hired African-American clerks in his store. Sam Evans was an African-American. He had a restaurant called The Bamboo Room. He hired Japanese-American waitresses. Pilgrim House was a social services agency in the neighborhood. And they hired Sam Ishikawa as basically a liaison. His job was to work on bringing the African and Japanese American communities together. Jim Hodge was an African American. He had a newsstand in front of the Civic Hotel, which eventually went back to being the Miyako Hotel. And he was sort of beloved by everybody in the neighborhood through the 70s. He was there for 30 years. And he used to carry the African American papers, like the Eagle and the LA Sentinel and the LA Tribune. And he'd also carry the bilingual Japanese American papers, so the Rafu Shimpo or the Kashu Mainichi. The Tribune shared its printing plant with a Nisei weekly paper called Crossroads. This is Almina and Lucius Lomax, who ran the Tribune during the war. And they really tried to use the paper as a way to facilitate conversation between Little Bronze Tokyo's two communities. So Almina, she covered Japanese American civil rights activism. And to do that, she hired Japanese Americans onto the paper. And one of the people she hired on the paper was Hisae Yamamoto, who became a very well-known author and writer later on in her life. And she wrote regular columns in the Tribune. Almina called her Sai. So Sai wrote regular columns in the Tribune and tried to address Japanese and African Americans' struggle to understand each other outside of the existing framework of the 1940s that only gave them kind of like racial lenses with which to look, right? She in one column, she wrote about a friend of hers named Chester. He's a waiter. And he, at the restaurant where he worked, he noticed that the white waiters and the black waiters and the Japanese American waiters were all eating their lunch in little racially segregated groups. He thought, that's weird, I don't get that. So he went at lunch and sat with the black waiters. And when he did that, afterwards, all the Japanese American waiters came up to him and they were really angry. They said, what are you doing, Chester? You're lowering the Japanese to do that. And you're deterring the flowering of Japanese white friendship. We have to get these white folks to like us. We don't want them to send us away again. And he said, well, I don't agree with that. So next lunch, he goes back. He sits at the same table with the black waiters again. And then one of the black waiters turns to him and he says, you know, Chester, I really like you. You're not like a Japanese at all. So this way, Yamamoto is very sort of gentle and subtle, you know, and she uses humor. But she kind of points out and says, yes, okay, let's admit many Japanese Americans have adopted these negative attitudes and behaviors towards African Americans. from the dominant society. But let's also recognize that Black people also have indulged in stereotypes, have condoned Japanese Americans' marginalization, right? Let's look at the ways in which we're both implicated in this. So in the end, you know, I'm often asked, well, then what happened to Bronzeville? Like, why don't we have a Bronzeville anymore? We just have a Little Tokyo. And what happened was that Little Bronze Tokyo ceased to exist less due to tensions between Japanese and African Americans than as a result of further action by the state, by municipal leaders, who viewed the property of that area, property associated with either of these two communities, as less valuable and thus easier to manipulate than property that was owned by Anglos, or the property that was occupied by Anglos, right? It's kind of back to the same idea as being expressed in the Times article or that movie that I showed the poster of, which is the representation of the neighborhood is very negative, and thus it becomes easier to intervene in that neighborhood than in other neighborhoods, right? So what happened was, in 1950, the city announced plans to take this block by purchase or eminent domain, because they were going to build the Parker Center Police Headquarters. And they needed someplace to build it, and they said, oh, this block. This is the block of Little Tokyo. It's, if you go down there now, it's bounded by Main, Los Angeles, First, and Temple Streets, where Parker Center is today. This is what was there before Parker Center. That's about a quarter of the neighborhood at that time. It's a really big block. And all of these newly reestablished Japanese American businesses had to move out, or they just went out of business, because they'd just been getting reestablished. And also, there was about 3,000 people who lived on this block, and 90% of them were African American, and they all had to move out. So that occurrence really is kind of the end of Bronzeville as it had existed, and also really of Little Bronze Tokyo as it came into existence after the war. And yet the connections that were forged there carried over and deepened in the neighborhoods along Jefferson and Crenshaw. Right? So here we get to this connection between these two spaces. Because after the racially restrictive deed covenants were declared unenforceable in 1948 by the US Supreme Court, you know, Anglo people are moving out to more and more kind of distant and brand new suburbs, right? They can get a brand new house outside the city. So the houses around Crenshaw increasingly become available now to African and Japanese American families. Realtors like Kazuo Inoue advertise these homes in the Black newspapers and the Japanese American newspapers. And places like the Holiday Bowl, so if you've gotten in Southland when she talks about the Family Bowl, this is the Holiday Bowl, fielded multiracial bowling leagues. And if you went in their coffee shop, you could get teriyaki and grits and, you know, mix it up. From the mid-1950s to the mid-60s, Dorsey High, down by Crenshaw, had roughly equal enrollments of African-American, Japanese-American, and white students. You used to see African and Japanese-American youth joining neighborhood gangs in Crenshaw, like the Ministers. And one of the Japanese-American members said, you know, we talked about the black and white conflict and that we were in it too, and we identified ourselves with blacks. So Crenshaw, as you'll see as you keep reading Southland, the rich connections and political commitments across generations, across multiple communities that are documented in her novel, that's one of the legacies of the short-lived merger of Bronzeville and Little Tokyo that I've described today. So for me, the legacies of Little Tokyo and Bronzeville continue to impact the landscape and the social fabric of Los Angeles beyond Crenshaw too, right? So we still, you see this all the time. We try to fix and simplify places that are fluid and diverse by sticking some kind of name on it. Like, this is Thai Town. This is Little India. This is Little Armenia. And we mark them off by doing that from other space that's supposedly American landscape or that's kind of figured as white landscapes. And we still allow the stereotypes associated with a space to shape the material resources that the people in those spaces can access and the forms of state intervention or economic investment that are accepted within them. You know, first, Leimert Park, for example, is an African-American neighborhood. First, they weren't going to get a metro stop, so they were going to be left out of the transit future. Now they're going to get a metro stop, and the property values have gone up, and suddenly these community institutions like World Stage and SO1 Books are in danger of closing down, right? And I think we still daily negotiate the competing claims to space and to opportunity and to belonging of these multiple, diverse, complex communities that actually live and work in these neighborhoods and suburbs of Southern California that we try to simplify with our cute little nicknames and our easy metonyms. So I look at Compton, for example. Both the structural challenges it's faced and the efforts made by African Americans and Latinos to overcome them, and I think about Bronzeville. I think about how some of the relationships forged in Little Bronze Tokyo, along with some of the distrust, shaped later developments in Gardena. I think about the similarities between Boyle Heights and Monterey Park, and the differences, too. And I think about Crenshaw. So I ask you to think about your neighborhoods also, and how they're haunted by the ghosts of these places past. So thank you so much.